Pastor R. Norheim presenting the gospel in sermon and song, sponsored by the Lutheran Gospel Association at Sedona, California. Released on a special network of selected radio stations in the United States, Canada, and overseas, and supported by free will contributions of listeners. When we regularly state that we present the gospel in sermon and song, we want to be known as conservative, evangelistic broadcasters of the good news that Jesus came to this world to save poor lost sinners. And it seems that our regular listeners identify us in this way for which we are pleased. Do Erickson and I sing for you first today a number that's now sung all around the world, How Great Thou Art. Lauren Whitney and Dick Boak accompany.
Then sing my song.
JoAnne adds her amen to today's theme as she sings He is the theme of my song. until WHWL, the Marquette Christian radio station, mentioned it in their recent folder. So all of you Amoses out there, lift your heads and thank God. You've been named well, burden bearer. That's what Jesus came to be, born in a stable, denying himself the average comforts and pleasures of life. He gave himself sacrificially, taking our burdens on his back. We thank all of you burden bearers who make possible these Lutheran Gospel Hour broadcasts. Being dedicated co-laborers, you are also helping burdened listeners to come to Christ, but also their burdens are lifted. Thank you very much. You do remember that the mailing address is Lutheran Gospel Hour, Post Office Box 12, Pasadena, California. And in Canada, it's Lutheran Gospel Hour, Post Office Box 201, Saskatoon, Saskatchewan.
And now, before Associate Evangelist Willmore Gundersen speaks, he and his wife sing De My Gläder Mest Am Jesus.
Previously here, Jesus had been speaking to the scribes and to the Pharisees, And he had spoken to them about their pride, about their hypocrisy, about the double dealing in their life when it came to religious things. And he spoke to them and summed it all up and said that whoever exalts himself shall be humbled, and whoever humbles himself shall be exalted. So there are really three things I would like to touch on today when it comes to humiliation. What hinders humiliation, the need for humiliation, and the result of humiliation. And first of all, what hinders humiliation in our lives? I believe something worthwhile mentioning is our own nature does. We can take, for example, in our life, how is our nature? We're greedy. We're envious. We're selfish. The Bible tells us, we can read, for example, there in Romans, the first chapter, and we've got a whole long list of how our nature is. And let me just take an example here for you about the children. How many times haven't you heard in your own home where a child will say something like this, "Look, Mommy, see what I can do? See?" Pride is something that is built into every person, and greed and pride really go hand in hand. Another thing that hinders humiliation is the world itself. We can take, maybe you're working on a job, and use this as an example. And you come in on spiritual things. You maybe say that, well, I go to church on Sunday and I hear the word of God. And maybe they'll say to you something along the line, "What do you mean? You go for that kind of Sunday school stuff, huh? I thought you were a guy that could manage all by yourself. Are you that type of a person who's got to go to church?" And we'll meet opposition from the world itself. We can take the matter of sin, where people today want to excuse sin. They don't want to call sin any longer. They'll call it a sickness. They'll call it something else, but they won't call it sin. That's the way the world is, and that hinders humiliation in a person's life. Because the Bible tells us where they acknowledge our sin. We're not to cover it up. We're not to excuse it, like so many are doing today. And we can take the matter of guilt as well, where even psychologists today, they say along with, "What do you mean? We don't have to be guilty. You know, other people live this way, and the matter of the free will, we want to live the way we want to. Nobody's gonna bother you. They're making laws today to make it tolerable too, so that you can live the way you want to. And the matter of guilt, you just have to erase from your mind. Forget about it, you know? This type of a thing." So you notice how this... Another thing that hinders humiliation is Satan himself. He doesn't want us to be humble. Oh, no, he doesn't. I can take, for example, a man in the Bible. His name is King David. And I can just visualize how Satan worked in his life. And he said, David, you're a king. You can do what you want. The world is at your feet. What do you mean you're taking somebody else's life? For what? For what? You're king. You're the leader of the land. You can do what you want. And God said, you can't. No matter who you are, if you're president, if you're vice president, or all the way down the line to a fisherman or a baker, whatever it may be, you cannot do what you want. The Bible tells us that sin is sin, and we're not to excuse. And we notice where hindrance along the line comes in our life to hinder humiliation. And I want to then secondly touch on the need of humiliation in our life. Is it needed? Yes. Okay, and maybe you say, why is it needed then? Because God says it's needed. And I'm going to give you a few verses today that underline this. And I'll start out with 1 Peter, the 5th chapter and verse 6, where God says, "Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God." All right, then again, Philippians 2:3, he says, "In humility, count others better than yourselves." Can you do this? You count others better than yourselves. Then again, Proverbs 15:33, "Humility goes before honor," God says. We can take in the book of Numbers, the 12th chapter, reading about Moses there. Moses was very neat, more than all the men that lived upon the face of the earth. We can take another man, for example, John the Baptist, something just beautiful written about that man, where it says like this, he shall increase and I shall decrease. That was the gold in John the Baptist's life. Yes, there's a need for humility, because God craves it. He wants us to practice humility, to observe humility. And I'd like to ask you today, are you obedient towards the Word of God? Are you? Do you bow your heart to the reign of the Lord Jesus Christ? Do you allow the Lord to work in your life? Do you say, Lord, not my will, but thine be done? Oh, if we can learn to pray that way in all sincerity, Lord, Lord, not my will. No, but thine be done in my life. May your will be done in my life. Now, we observe Scripture. Search it. Search the Word of God for yourself. One important thing is that salvation comes as a result of humiliation. This is what the Bible tells us. And let me just read for you a verse from the Old Testament that really speaks very clear along this line. In 2 Chronicles, the 7th chapter and verse 14, it's a very well-known verse. And my people were called by my name, humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways. Then I will hear from heaven and forgive their sin and will heal their land. You see how the Lord tells you? If you humble yourself, he'll forgive your sin. That's it over here. He'll come into your life. And salvation comes as a result of humiliation. Let me take the Jewish people as an example. When they were confronted with Jesus Christ as he walked the dusty streets of Jerusalem, for example, some would say to him, Jesus, we're not born in sin. Our father is Abraham. And they would ramble on along this line. And the Word of God tells them and tells us, either we're Jews or Gentiles, he tells all of us, that our nature, we are by nature the children of wrath. We're sinful by nature. We're not sinless. Therefore, we need salvation. That's what the Jews need. That's what you need. That's what I need. And salvation comes as a result of humiliation. The Bible tells of the Jewish people how in the Old Testament we read they were stiff-necked people. God had revealed himself to them, proven himself to them, but time and time again they rejected him. They were just stiff-necked. They would not humble themselves. And we see how they were rewarded accordingly. Then thirdly, I want to mention the result of humiliation. When we read in the Bible about the first Christians, one thing that is very beautifully expounded on for us there is that a sentence along this line, see how they love one another. There had come a change about in their life. That was so noticeable. The world noticed there was something so very different from before. Now they loved one another. They even loved their enemies. They loved, of course, the Lord Jesus Christ, but they loved their neighbors. They loved the people that were even against them. The result of humiliation was noticeable. And the Bible tells us that a Christian, he is not free from trials or temptations by any means. No, no one else. But in humbleness, when trial comes, when temptations come, we've got one we can go to. And we can ask him for daily help, for strength, for guidance. And the Bible tells us, if we humble ourselves in before the Lord, the Bible underlines for us that the Lord will look to that person. And he will even exalt that person in due time. And I'm going to touch on this in a moment. And therefore, it's so important for us to see that humility should be a must in our life. And it has to be a must in our life if we're to get it right with the Lord and if we're to walk right together with Him. We will then find favor with God. That's what the Bible tells us. And whoever humbles himself will find favor with God. He will be exalted, we read up here. The Lord will honor that person. And the Lord will give to you the just and right reward in due season. I see my time is gone. Let us close in prayer. Jesus, I pray that you may bless every soul listening. Help us to live a life in humility before thee. We pray and ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Will you give heed to this message today?